I don't wanna be sleeping while the battle is raging. Yes,
I don't fight, I just wanna mix the air. Give me eyes to see and ears to hear. I don't fight, I just wanna mix the air. Give me eyes to see and ears to hear. I don't fight, I just wanna mix the air. Give me eyes to see and ears to hear. I don't fight, I just wanna mix the air.
Sorry about that. Good evening. How are we doing? Man, I think school is kicking some bottoms. Lori's like, I'm a teacher. Heck yes. Yes. All right. Can I have everybody that's in the back, if y'all can go ahead and come on in, take a seat for me. Let's see what we really got going on here.
Thank you. before you touch.
Okay.
You know, it's like that new toy. No matter how many you have, it's like, just ask mama. If you're not sure, just ask mama and daddy first. Better safe than sorry. Because, you know, especially when you have had as many boys as they've had and now you've got a little girl, it changes everything. So if everybody could please let's stand. We're going to do a song to get us kind of going and moving around. It was really heavy on my heart after watching some of the prayer stuff from pastors for the missions to really, really step up our intercession and our warfare. They are already receiving some demonic attacks, and they have been in prayerful intercession themselves, and they have been able to smite the enemy already. But the enemy is hot on their trails. The more they move into the areas that they are in, the more the attack is greater, the more the demonic is trying to rise up against them. And this is an opportunity as a corporate body for us to come into unity and in agreement that we will not stand for the schemes of the enemy. We will not stand for them at all. And that whatever the Lord would have done would be released. And we silence the enemy and do not tolerate any of their interference, distractions, whatever it might be, to cause whatever the Lord would have to be delayed. Because God's word will be released. God's power and authority will be released, and it will not be tamed by no liar. Amen. So that's one of the things we're going to be doing tonight. But first and foremost, we want to surrender it. We want to lay it down and invite him in. So that's what we're going to do with this first song tonight. Okay? So prepare your hearts. While we're playing and leading into this, please pray for the chair next to you. When school starts, it's always a little crazy. But we love our body, and we want them to be here. So please, think of the people that are normally sitting around you, and just pray. And if you think about them during the week, reach out to them. You know, the more we do it, all of us can touch the people that are here. You're important, every single one of you. Every single one of you, and you have a position and nobody else can fill it but you. So when you're not here, it's a void. And we don't want you to not be here. We know life happens at times, but it's so much more greater the more bodies we have to come into agreement and rattle the gates of heaven for our Lord. Amen? All right. You ready? You ready? Come on, you gotta act more excited than that. Woo! Come on, guys. Yes.
Hand on my heart, this smile.
will be my joy and say,
oh yes,
your will, your way. You will be my joy and say, your will, your way. It will be my joy and say, your will.
Come on, keep going.
Your way, always.
Oh, it will be my joy.
You will be my joy and say, your will, your way.
Privilege of getting to tell a very special young lady happy sweet 16. So if you would sing with me so we can embarrass her, because that's my job. So okay, Drunken Sailors, I'm just giving you the prequel. Okay, let's do it. Happy birthday. Her mama's look when she's not happy, because see, Kelly has the same look when I'm not happy, so I got the Amy look. Ooh, I'm in trouble. If you would please put your hands together, Miss Kim is going to give the nugget.
I'm like super excited to be able to share with y'all what the Lord's put in my heart. It's really crazy that we just sang that song, because that's exactly what we're going to talk about tonight, is that one of the things I've gone before the Lord, and when I first got saved, I remember my heart being freshly graded, and I remember appreciating everything. I remember everything being brand new, and I remember just loving everybody, and I remember when the Bible started being illuminated to me, and I remember it being in Ephesians, and I remember reading the words that the Apostle Paul said when he talked, the Apostle Paul said when he talked about the church, and when he wrote to the church, and how he called them. He's like, my beloved, my crown, my joy, my beloved. And the way that he loved, and the way that he talked to the people, the way that he said, Lord, if I could sacrifice my life and my ticket to heaven so that all of them could get it and have a chance and have salvation, I will lay down my life. I will lay down my life so that they can have a chance. And I remember going before the Lord and telling him, he loves like Jesus, and I want to love like that. I want to love people that way. And I didn't know what I was asking for. Because this is what we're asking for. We're saying, I lay me down. I lay my life down. And I sacrifice your will, your way. but every opportunity that he presents before me, I'm like, oh. Like, when I was offered the opportunity and to serve in the youth ministry, it was in the shadow of Jared. And I'm like, I came in thinking, you know, I'm just being supportive. I'm just helping. I'm offering my help to my husband so that he's successful. And the Lord just totally transformed me, and he poured out his grace upon my life, and he illuminated the word to me, and he gave me the ability to open my mouth and speak and to get people's attention. And I was like, what is this? Like, I've never even dreamt that I would stand in front of people and talk, much less have them captivated by the words that are coming out of my mouth through the Holy Spirit. I never knew that the Lord, I'm always waiting for God to move. I'm always waiting for the Holy Spirit to move around me. I didn't know that he's moving through me. It was the first revelation I had that we're not waiting on a move of God. We're the move of God. We are the move, the hands, we're the feet, and we're the ones that have to sacrifice, and we're the ones that have to lay down our lives. And I started thinking what it looks like to be a Christian and what it looks like to humble yourself. And you can have this back. Rob, oh, man, last week, I'm telling you, it has bloomed like a flower, all the message that he gave, and it's a hard message. But guess what? The Lord loves you so much that he's not going to leave you in the darkness that you're in. And it hurts when he flashes the light at you and shows you what is inside of you. And this week, the Lord has really been humbling me. He had opened the windows of heaven, and he allowed the Holy Spirit to pour out on me. It was like I plugged into the Holy Spirit, and all of a sudden, I knew all of these things. It was like I hadn't gone to school for them. I didn't learn it from the Bible. I confirmed it with the Bible, but he was teaching me, and he was pouring out on me, and I was knowing all this stuff, and I started looking around me, and he said, do you want to love like I love? Do you really want to love like I love? And I'm like, yes, Lord, I desire to love how you love. And he was like, well, that requires me shedding light on your darkness. And it requires you to step out. And it's embarrassing. It's shameful. It's uncomfortable. And it doesn't feel good. And he said, if I came today, you wouldn't be ready. If I came today, you would be left. And I'm like, Lord, I give you all my time. Every day that I have is dedicated to you. Everything that I do is for you. And he goes, that's why I tell people in the script, I have all these scriptures, and he's just, all that matters is that you know what the word says. And he says that even people who preach will be left behind. People who are standing up here worshiping me will be left behind. People that I use to heal, he goes, you are not worthy. It's not your worthiness is why I use you. So just because I get up here and I talk and the Holy Spirit comes out through me, I still have ugliness inside of me. And I was like, Lord, I'm not ugly. I was like, I love you and I want to serve you, and I'm asking where I can serve you. But just last week, he showed me some ugliness I had in me because Janie does Meals of Grace once a month, and she goes and she serves the community, and she needs help. She can't do it by herself. They've closed streets because they don't have enough people to help, and they offer help, and it's an opportunity to serve your God and your Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for you, who didn't feel like doing it, but he did it anyway. And it's an opportunity to serve that God. And instead of people jumping on the opportunity to serve and to be the hands and feet of Christ, people are having to be assigned because nobody is stepping up. And he hit my heart, and he told me, you volunteer to serve. And I'm like, Lord, I already do youth ministry. I already, every Monday night, every Sunday, every Wednesday, I was like, Tuesday nights, I'm in the hospital. Thursday nights, I'm in the hospital. Friday nights, I'm in the hospital. Saturday morning is my only morning with Kaylee, just me and her. And it's my time that I rest before Sunday. I get up and I come to church in the morning and in the evening and to the pastor's meetings. I was like, my life is just so planned out. I didn't even have time for God to interrupt my life with a blessing. And he blessed me because I volunteered and I called her and I said, I don't know what I just got myself into. I don't know what I just did. I was like, but I am so busy and I really don't have time for this, but I'm going to do it. You just tell me what to do and I'll do it. And I got to meet some of the most wonderful people. And I was like, this is living. This is what it feels like to live. What I had planned was not living. When I'm in the hospital visiting sick people, that's living, because the power of God comes through you. The grace of God comes upon you. And you get to experience him firsthand. And it is awesome. And I was like visiting all of those people and feeding all of those people and loving on them and praying for them. It was like, it's like such a joy. I was like, this is awesome. Why do people not volunteer for this? This is the grace of God upon you. God touching you, paying attention to you because you're paying attention to his people. It was awesome. The whole thing with the Lord grading my heart and showing this to me was that he was showing me what it takes to do the scripture that Rob brought up to us. And it was, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray. And I really meditated on that scripture, and I was like, what does it mean to humble yourself? And I started looking at it, what it means to humble yourself, and it was like all this exposure of who you are and what's inside of you. And I was having a conversation with God, and I was telling him, I'm a good person. I'm serving you. I'm going to church. I'm doing all this stuff. And what he told me was that it doesn't matter. Like, that's not the point of it. The point is a relationship with me and doing what I tell you to do, not what you want to do, not what you think I want you to do, not any of that stuff. Like, it doesn't matter. Thank you, but no thank you. That's not what I'm asking you to do. And so in order for us to get together and actually do what it is that we need to do, we need to be open for him to interrupt our lives. We need to be a living sacrifice. It's his will, not ours. And that's uncomfortable. And so he started showing me. I was like, Lord, where do I need to humble myself? Where? Show me. And he was like, all right. He goes, if I just peeled back the veil and stepped in front of you, you would die of shame right now. And I was like, I really had to think about it. I'm like, me? Are you kidding me? I'm like nearly perfect. No, I'm so not. You can ask my husband. It's like, he lets me know all the time. But what he showed me was, like, in the presence of the Lord and in the presence of the Holy Spirit, you reveal yourself, not just with who you are, but your thoughts reveal themselves, your heart reveals itself, every feeling that comes up inside of you that you don't say, that you get to put on a smile. And he showed me something with my job, and he showed me something with my home too, but that would require me exposing other people, so I'm just going to tell you about me. Is like, today I had 80 patients, and the Lord was talking to me all day today, and I when I have 80 patients, I tell my boss, I was like, I don't like these days because it feels like I'm hurting people like cattle, and it frustrates me because we're graded and critiqued on everything we do, and if you rush people through like that, you don't get very good reviews. But to have an encounter with each and every one of them. And the Lord just freshly graded my heart. So it's like time stopped. And I got to spend time and have encounters with all the patients. Never have I done 80 patients. It was an overwhelming day. And I had time. And I had energy. And then I'm here. And it's by the grace of God. And he showed me that it has nothing to do with my worthiness. I'm a sinner. And my heart is sick. But he showed me the times when my heart's not graded. He showed me my thought process, and I didn't even know that I thought these things. I didn't even know I did these things, because they're just how we live. And he showed me that we need to vamp our lifestyle and the way we live, because this is what he showed me. I work in the pulmonary department. And people come into our pulmonary department, and the first things out of their mouth are, they didn't really think about what they did when they made the pulmonary department this far away from the parking lot up on the fourth floor, where we have to walk and we can't breathe and we're wearing oxygen and we're huffing and puffing. And in my mind, my thought process is, it's not my fault you didn't take care of your temple. It's not my fault that you smoke. It's not my fault that you wear oxygen. And it's not my fault. I was like, I have no sympathy for you, because where I park, is a lot further than when you park. And this is my thought, but in my face, this is how I'm reacting. Oh, I'm so sorry that you have to do that. And is there anything I could do to help you? Or can I get you a wheelchair? Or can I get you an oxygen tank? This is what's coming out of my face, but in my mind, I'm like, it is not my fault that you did not take care of yourself. You know? And that's the ugliness that God's talking about. When you step in front of him, you're not ready. Because when he shows you the ugliness that is actually up here and in here, it's ugly. And you might think it's okay, and you might think it's funny, and we might tolerate it from each other, and we might pat each other on the back for it, but he says it's not right. It's ugly. We're supposed to love each other. So he freshly graded my heart today, and not by my own ability, because my own ability is snapping back at people in my mind while I'm smiling on my face and saying, I'm so sorry you had to walk so far. I'm so sorry you can't breathe. I'm so sorry that you need oxygen, you know? And today he showed me, he melted my heart, and I loved everybody. I really literally felt love. He broke my heart, and I literally felt pain for them, and I wanted to pray for them. And they're trapped in bondage, and they're confused, and they're in darkness, and they don't get it. And he's called us to step up and to love them and to pray for them and to bring them out of it and to help them. Even if it's just a smile, even if it's just, can I pray for you? Even if it's just, can I get you a wheelchair and mean it? Even if it's like, let me get you an oxygen tank because anything I can do to relieve your suffering. Loving him. And he broke my heart, and he showed me that today. And he said if he came today, we're not ready. And so he said to tell you guys to search your heart, like really search your heart. Without God, you don't know where your darkness is. It takes him shining his light on your darkness for you to realize it. Otherwise, it is impossible to repent. Ask him to show you the ugliness in your heart to get rid of it, because we're going to stand before him. And it's soon. There's like an urgency, like get ready, get ready. Wake up, you sleepers, wake up. The pastors are always telling you, wake up. Oh, sleepers, wake up. Get up and do something. I'm telling you, I do and I do and I do and I do and I do for the Lord, and I'm not right. He's showing me that I'm not right. And he says, none of you are right. None of us are right. All have sinned. All have fallen short. All, there's something in every single one of us that is ugliness. I don't care how sweet and nice you are. He's like, it doesn't matter what other people think of you and see in you. I see everything, all the things you think nobody knows about. I see that. I know that. The things you think, the things that are in your heart, those emotions that come up inside of you when you're shaking people's hand and telling them, I love you, brother. I love you, sister. And inside you're like, that person gets on my nerves. We're ugly, guys. And we need to get right. We need to check our hearts. If we don't check them, he's going to check them, and it's not going to be nice. If he does it, and it's not something he does to be mean. It's something he does out of love. He's like, come on, guys, get out of the darkness. Let's get empowered. Let's get praying for people. Let's heal people. Let's do all of this. But while you're stuck in the darkness and you can't get over your own heart sickness, how are you going to help anybody else? We have to check our hearts. I have a lot of scripture, and I didn't get to say any of them, but that's all right because he's in control.
Good job, Kim. See, Jared will tell you based on Kim's nugget, God is a God of revelation. Okay, just really quick, guys. This is very serious, but it goes along with what you're saying as far as being ready, okay? This is a very serious text message that we need to pray over, and I don't mean just like pray and not mean it. I mean pray and mean it, okay? I got a text from Annette a minute ago. It says, we're traveling into dangerous areas today. Please have the church pray. And I said, I will. But I was in the midst of 100 other things. So I will when I get around to it. But the next text message said, this was Sunday that she's referring to, there was a massive 30-person killing. They were shot and they were burned in a field on Sunday. Two different terror groups are fighting. Freedom fighters were deployed. The church that Donnie preached at had three of the terror group guys there to see what he would say. Those are the ones who kidnapped the foreigners. Anyway, lots of activities. Right now, we're heading into that. So we as a body need to come together and not just kind of pray half-heartedly, because our pastors' lives could very well depend on that. Okay, and their hearts are in the right place that they would be willing to lay down their lives for Christ, or they wouldn't be where they are doing what they're doing right now. Okay, so Rob, that's you, buddy.
Let's stand together and grab a hand. We'll join hearts as we grab each other's hands. Our hearts will be joined and united before the Lord. Father, we just come before you now in the name of Christ. We lift up this whole team to you that's there with boots on the ground, and especially our pastors. Our souls are knit with them, and we just pray in Christ's name that your angels would be posted around them to protect, but also, Lord, that your Spirit would go before them and be on them, in them, around them, that your peace that surpasses understanding would settle on their hearts and in their minds. Give them great confidence because they fear you, Lord. And your scripture says those who have holy fear have abundant and great confidence. And so, Lord, let that be the order of their day. But outside of them, we pray that your Spirit would go before them. That in the very atmosphere, the angelic host would be marshaled as an army, as a vanguard, to surround them and accompany them every place that they set their foot, Lord. May that be a place of opportunity for the glory to be made manifest. Pray, O God, for your presence to be made manifest in that place. And as they walk forward with hearts that are committed to you, let there be a boldness that comes upon them, Lord, to speak the truth. When they declare, Lord, let it come to pass on earth as it is in heaven. When they bind and loose, let it be those things that you've decreed from heaven would be bound and loosed. Lord, I pray for Cheryl and her prophetic messages. I pray for all of those who will minister on this very day. As we go to sleep tonight, they'll be in the thick of it. And so, Father, we lift up our hearts, we lift up our hands to exalt your name. And Father, we intercede as a priestly body that you've created us to be. Hear our cry, hear our prayer, O Lord. And even now, send your angelic host in answer to our prayer. This we pray in Christ's name. I would invite you to make a decision now. For those of you who are members here, you probably already know, but I'm going to tell you anyway, for the benefit of those who may not be, that you can bring cash. There are envelopes up here. You can scribble your name on there if you want that to be credited to your account or your giving for end of year kind of stuff. You can also give online if you're a member. But other than that, we would ask that you would make sure, and in a moment when we make announcements and stuff, the guys are going to be passing the buckets around. And so just make it a matter of prayer. Make it a matter of asking the Lord what he would have us to do and give. Amen.
Okay.
Okay, hi guys. My responsibility is to tell y'all what's happening here at the Point. So, some of the things that are taking place, we have prayer, first and foremost, Sunday morning at 7 o'clock, and Tuesday evenings at 6:30 p.m. If you're an intercessor, come. If you're not an intercessor, but you realize that you're called to pray, come anyway, especially now with our pastors. And if you can't make it, pray at home, pray wherever you are. Also, Destiny classes. Secret Place is still going on in the mornings, starts at 9 o'clock. Greg still has a couple of classes left of Grace, Meditate, and Translate Divine Favor. Motivational Gifts originally was announced to start this coming Sunday. It will be pushed back 1 week. So Motivational Gifts will start on 9/11. If you've never been through a Motivational Gifts class, please consider taking that class. Amy and Kirk do that class. They do a fantastic job. It'll help you realize what you may think you know what makes your juices juice, what makes you do, get up off your seat and do something, but they'll help you put a name to that and help get you plugged in, because how many know you're called to actually come and join in and serve here and not come and to sit in a seat? Everybody know that? We all have a part. Okay. So that will start 9/11. Song of Solomon will start on the 25th. Awesome, awesome class. You want to know how much Jesus loves you? Come to Song of Solomon. Annette will be doing that in the evenings. We also have life classes. Life classes are really, really special to me. We have several. Overcomers Recovery is going on right now. Overcomers Recovery is an addiction class. It is an addiction class that will deal with all kinds of things that you may not even consider as an addiction. What is it that drives you? If you've got something that drives you to do something that maybe is not bad, but maybe it's a bad habit, but it's a driving force. This class will work for workaholics. It works for alcoholics. It works for sex addicts. It works for shoppers. How many shopaholics do we have? Okay, drugs, alcohol, it's not just that. Overeating. Hello. Enough said about that. We have a financial freedom class that Ralph will be starting on the 18th in the evening at 6:30. Come if you need to learn how to do a budget, if you want to learn how to save money, if you want to learn how to really be a good steward. God gives us so much, and he expects us to be good stewards. That class will help you learn that. We also have available marriage classes and parenting classes. Whenever we know that there are people that are ready, we've got a lot of people that have already taken them, but you can take them at any time. Doesn't matter if your children are teenagers, you can still take it. If you're a grandparent, it still applies. I want you to consider getting involved in Destiny. We all need to learn how to grow so we can all work together. Now, with the prayer that's just been prayed, with the word that's just gone out, you know where our pastors are. You know what they're facing. Now we have an opportunity to war in the Spirit as we praise and worship. Our warring that we do here covers where they are there. Okay? So come up and let's war and praise God. Oh yeah, I'm sorry, I forgot. September 10th, soaking. What's not soaking?
On September 10th from 9 to 11, we're going to do prayer for the missions. Annette's still going to be going to Sri Lanka after they get done in the Philippines. She's going to be leaving on, I think, the 8th. They're going to be going towards there, and then they'll be doing more missions next. pray for that, September 10th, 9 to 11. We're not going to be doing soaking music, so I'm not labeling it that.
All right. I need some warriors up here at the front. People who aren't afraid to get down and get a little crazy in the battle. Look, Niecy said, give me room. She said, elbow room, please. Come on, guys. I know it was a little long on stuff this evening, but let's get focused. The battle is at hand, and we have marching orders. Come on.
The battle is raging. The devil is raging. I don't want to be sleeping while the battle is raging. For the battle is raging. I don't want to be sleeping while the battle is raging, yeah. I don't fight, just want to beat the air. Yeah.
time again.
I don't fight as one who beats the air. So give me eyes to see it.
Come on, do it again.
I don't fight as one who beats the air.
Come on, we're well armed. Come on, I don't fight.
I don't fight as one who beats the air. Give me eyes to see and ears to hear. I don't fight as one who beats the air. Give me eyes to see and ears to hear. I don't fight as one who beats the air. Give me eyes to see and ears to hear. I don't fight as one who beats the air. Give me eyes to see and ears to hear.
Come on. I want you to transition into declaration. We're going to tell the enemy that our pastors are well equipped for the battle at hand. And not only are they well equipped, but they go with the natural and the supernatural army of the Lord. And one of those armies is in this house. So whether you're sitting or you're standing, take your position in the army and start declaring. Because you have a place. You sing it out, you know it.
They are mighty through our God. Oh, the weapons of our war.
Come on!
They are mighty through Woo! Our God. They are mighty through our God.
Oh, the weapon.
come on. Day and night and night and day. Day and night and night and day. 24/7. Tree, there was no bush, there was no fruit. You hardly noticed that there was even a stump there. But I saw the pastors being able to identify them. They pulled them up, and every root was attached. Not one could break free. And as they pulled it up and the entire thing left the ground, it completely disintegrated. There was nothing left.
King of kings, you are my everything. awestruck wonder at the mention of your name.
Come on, sing this again.
I'm filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name.
Come on, one more time. I'm filled with wonder, yes.
Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name.
Come on, tell him Jesus.
Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water. Such a marvelous victory.
We adore you. God, we just rest in your presence tonight. Because again, it's not about us. It's about you and your glory and your holiness. In this moment, God, we rest. No matter what we might have walked in with, God, no matter what was happening on the outside of these walls, it doesn't even matter because we're here for you tonight. God, we just rest in your presence. Holy Spirit, come. More. Father, we thank you. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Wow. Great job. Great job. Down, please.
Fills up in my soul.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Is that good? Good. We good? We good? No. I'll come to you. Okay. Amazing. All right, first things first. My hair okay? We good? All right, that's all that matters. All right. Thank you. I debated on doing this or not. Not really debated, but it was really on my heart. There's some people here who aren't normally here that are very, very dear to me and very, very important to me. And I want y'all to stand up, please. You know who you are. Stand up. Thank you. These people, a great majority of them, have been in funeral homes with me. They've been inside my home, hospitals, the very high points of my life, the very low points of my life, what I call the pagan days or before Christ days. They were there. I mean, I had Jesus, but I was living like a pagan, which to me is worse than being a pagan itself, by definition. But these people, just, I'm so honored to have them here tonight, and especially one of them that's over there. I'm looking at you, Sam. That man I grew up underneath his, you too, Nana, you too. But I grew up, he was my pastor for about 19, 20 years when I lived here, and a great majority of what you see that is of God and good was a testament to this man's life and what he did and the life that I got to watch and see. So I just want to honor them tonight. So thank you for honoring them for me. Disclaimer. Anytime you hear that, it's normally this, it's going to be great. But just hear the disclaimer. This is something I'm currently walking through, currently trying to grasp and hold on to the fullest. It's something that's dearly important to me, not the first part of this message necessarily, but what comes out of it. And I just want you to hear my heart. This is not a corrective word in the sense of you're doing this wrong or maybe you're doing it right. Maybe you're like Kirk and you do everything right and that's great. So, but this is something that's very dear to my heart. And walking in everything, if Ashley could have known what I was teaching about tonight, which she didn't, and I'm glad that she didn't, but just the victory that we have through Christ, the victory that we have through Christ, not that we are gaining through Christ. Thank you, sister. Thank you. We have already gained this. Yes, we do war. Yes, we do battle. But we fight from victory, not for it. So there's your disclaimer. Another part of this disclaimer is it could be roughly a 10-minute message. Lucky for you, it's not going to be, but that's the truth. All right, let's get started. Amy, if you could, please, the Isaiah verse. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of morning, how you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. We need to stop right there. That's all I need. But at the end of verse 14, it says, Lucifer says, I will be like the Most High. Now, I bet you were not expecting that to come out of my mouth when I started this message, which is all fine, great, and grand. But it's important to know that we do have an enemy that was placed in the high place and that he gave up. He did. People call it the fall. He fell from heaven. No. He was pushed from heaven because of a decision that he personally made, that he stepped into this, that he made that decision. And if you've been in church for any length of time, you've heard about the fall or the push of Lucifer, right? Okay, so that with that being said, how many books of the Bible or how many verses, you don't have to answer, but in your head think are about the fall, right? That's a pretty big deal, right? Our enemy who has fallen, how much of the Bible is covered in that? Well, I'll save you a lot of time, a lot of Googling for most of you. For Rob or somebody, it might be cracking open a book. But for me, I was like, okay, here's this. All right. You got to be kidding me. This is a pretty big deal, right? No, okay, I guess it's not. All right, so I went to Rick Solomon. I said, Rick, what is the deal? Like, there's no information on this one thing that I'm looking for. It's a small part of this message, but I want to know more about it. Well, I won't tell you what Rick said. But, and I also went to Sam, and I said, Sam, here's the issue. Like, I can't find what I'm looking for. So I did the thing that we most often do, and or maybe it's just me, I'm sure y'all never do this, but we go to God for the answer after we've tried everything else. We go to God for the answer, right? Right? This is what we do. So I go to Holy Spirit, and I'm like, all right, look, to me this seems like a pretty big deal. Our enemy, the thing that we fight, although we're fighting from victory, I want to keep emphasizing that. Why? Like, why less than 10 verses? There's actually 8 verses that I could find. If there's more out there, please, you're welcome to correct me or send me more message about it later on. Don't do it right now, please. That would disrupt church. But I was thinking, like, what is this issue? And I said, Holy Spirit, can you just show me something? Just give me anything so when I stand in front of these people, I'm not rambling as I've been doing for 10 minutes, that I'm not doing that, that I'm not going to do that. Are you ready for this grand revelation? It's big. It's very, very, very big. This is the revelation that I got. He's a loser. He's lost. That's all he does, and that's all he can do. What more do you need to know? I don't. I'm looking for all this information that I could give you and try to impress you and say, this is in Ezekiel, and this is in Isaiah, and this is Jeremiah, and here's what Jesus said, and here's what Genesis, Exodus, everything that we have. I wanted to be able to provide you information, but tonight it's not about information necessarily from a doctrinal standpoint or theology or scriptural standpoint. It's the simple fact that we win, he loses, and the game's over. But we still have these battles, and I understand them. I'm not minimizing your battle. You know, there's several things going on in my life right now that I want to be like, oh, God, the enemy is so attacking me right now. That there's one, major, and I understand that death is a part of our lives, and we're all going to reach it, and when we get to Jesus and we get to be with him. But to watch a man that I have watched for over 70 years, well, I can't say 70 years because I'm only 28, but he's in his 70s, but a man that I've known my entire life to be this strength and honor and dignity die gradually for 2 years. I'm like, that's the enemy. That can't be God. No, you know what? My grandfather is going to glory. He's going to be in glory. And as long as he's living and breathing, he's going to be proclaiming God as he can, as much as he can. Because why? The battle's already won, right? So we have that. So now that we have that established, that's great. So I want to go on and say that obviously we have. So what happened to Satan afterwards? Where does he go? You can do this as a verbal thing. You can reply. Where was he cast down from heaven? Where did he go? Thank you. He is cast down to earth. We don't know if it was a day, or I don't. I guess I say we. Maybe you do. But we don't know if it was a day, 1,000 days, 1,000 years, a billion. I don't want to step on anybody's toes, but a billion years. I have no idea. I am not equipped to know that. I didn't ask Holy Spirit. Maybe he would have told me. But I don't know that answer. But what I can tell you is that he's cast down. So I'm going to make myself like the Most High. No, you're not. Boom, a third, and y'all know most of the story, right? So he's cast down to the earth. Safe to say he's having a bad day. You know, he's hanging out, and everything's good. I'm going to rebel. No, you're not. Boom, he's cast down to the earth. I do believe, based off what you can read in Job, I do believe that he still had to report to God. I think that he was still, I know that he, from what Job says, he still had to report to God. That's what I do know, although that's not all that important. Now, he's feeling the sting of defeat. He is roaming the earth, whatever you want to do, if he's a lion, snake, it doesn't matter, but whatever it is for you, think about it for just a moment. But he's sitting here, and then he hears, and if you can, Amy, go ahead. God spoke. First of all, that is the most vile thing to him. God spoke. That's his enemy. Yes, we're his enemy, but he, you know what I'm saying, vice versa. So, He hears God spoke, let us make human beings in our image and make them reflecting our nature so they can be responsible for the fish in the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, and yes, earth itself, and every animal that moves on the face of the earth. God created human beings. He created them godlike, reflecting God's nature. He created them male and female. God blessed them. Prosper. Are you prospering? Got kind of quiet and I hear sirens, so that's got to be God. Are you prospering? Reproduce. Fill the earth. Take charge. Be responsible. And it goes on, and we get it. Thank you. But so we have Satan. He's doing his thing in torment. I don't have all the answers. But what I do know is, to hear, he wanted to what? Make himself like the Most High, correct? He wanted to be like God. God's like, I got one for you. You know what he did? He made me. Satan was not put on this earth to torment me. No. I'm put on earth to torment him. So we have got to stop walking around with our tails tucked between our legs. Oh, brother, you know, God bless you, the enemy's got you, and just hang in there. Which really means I don't have an answer, I'm too weak, and I'm sorry. No, I'm not sorry. I don't have an answer for you, because if I say Jesus, you might turn away from Jesus or whatever the excuses that we have, and I think a lot of times it's good intentions. But if we're given this power and we're given this authority, and that we've been put on earth to torment him, not the other way around, because so many times we see it. We see it and we say, oh, he's attacking us. Oh, we give up. We go into our closet. We don't come to church for a month, a year, 6 years, 10 years, 20 years. We're mad at God. You want me to? All right. You asked for it. We are made in his image, in his likeness, in their likeness, Holy Spirit, Jesus, and God, and Father God. We're made in their likeness. That's why he can't stand us. We didn't even ask for what we got. He tried to usurp it, and he did not get it. So the very fact that you have breath in your lungs, he hates. But guess what? I'm going to keep saying it. We win. We win. Jesus, thank you. This is where it starts to hit home in what I was talking about. What are you proclaiming? Right? Either he's tormenting you or it's this way that I boil it down, pretty simple. What are you speaking out loud? Because in my own life, I go to work and I'm like, oh, hate this place. God, stupid people. They piss me off. Oh, sorry, not allowed to say that. I've been to some of your homes. You're welcome. But really, it's the truth. The power of life and death is in the power of the tongue. Say it again. Your own tongue. You were speaking and proclaiming things. The power that you have. The easiest thing that I can think of is when I get done on a Wednesday or something like that, and Kim's like, man, good message. I'm like, yes. I did something right. She's speaking life. That brings life to me. When she speaks that over me. When, I don't know, I think of one instance recently, I don't know, maybe a month ago or 6 weeks ago, my grandmother and her friend came over and Kim was saying, man, she just, your grandmother loves you. She really, really loves you. She was just bragging on you. She's speaking life. But let's take it to the big issues, right? Let's take it to, I don't know, 30 people being shot up in a different country where our pastors are at. Anything in right now in the natural, we are seeing them, and we're seeing that situation, and we can either go, oh man, the enemy's just all over that. No. God is all over that. You know what the Hebrew word, don't you do anything, or you, the Hebrew word all means, I'm just playing with them, all authority has been given to me. Now let's take this step further. You are a co-heir with Christ, yes? You are a co-heir with Christ. So if all authority has been given to him, heaven and earth, on earth as it is in heaven, earth should be beginning, or at least this church should beginning to start look like heaven. And what does that look like? It looks like love. It looks like going and serving meals. It looks like glory coming, healings happening, chains being broken. That's right. One person's getting it. Thank you, Jesus. That we have this power and we have this authority, but so many times, again, it's he's tormenting me. No, he's not. No, he's not. You've already got the victory. You already have this victory. He is defeated. And I'm telling you this in my own life. There's, like I said, several things that are going on right now, and I'm like, enemies just all over this. Enemies, and I don't, there's no mention of God in my brain. I'm being authentic. I know God's up here talking about, supposed to be encouraging you with God and saying these things about God, but there's no mention in my head of God. It's like, this bullcrap job, and I can't stand life, and I'm mad at the world. You hear me, right? I know you hear me up there too in the booth. This job is frustrating me. It's bothering me. What am I doing to change an environment? Well, the dark is just getting darker, brother. I'm not sure that's in the Bible. Or at least it's not in the Bible the way that you're saying it's in the Bible. We are meant to be salt and light. Darkness cannot exist as long as we are breathing. Torment cannot exist as long as pain cannot exist. We are called to be the light of the world, salt of the earth. That's it. Well, it's the end times, brother. I refuse to embrace an end times theology. Please let my heart be saved. That bad things have to happen before Christ comes back. Earthquakes are bad. In the Bible, the earthquake I know about, our king stepped out and we reigned victorious. That's the way it worked. And every little thing that happens, I'm not saying be oblivious to, but what I am saying is all these bad situations, what are you doing about it? You have this power and you have this authority. Your enemy has been defeated. We live from victory. We don't have to fight for it. We just have to say yes to him. We'll get to that later on. And I have a good old come to Jesus meeting. I would say that the great majority of us are fighting for victory. I'm being honest from an observation. This is the way that I perceive it, and this is the way that I see it. Well, you don't know what you're talking about, Brother Jared. I have Facebook too. Thank you, Brendan. That's the truth. That is your platform. And I love you all very dearly. I'm guilty of it. I know I've done it before. I try not to. But Facebook, that little thing in your, right here, this phone, is this. And you know, the old cliche is if somebody, you might be the only Bible somebody reads today. Well, here's my thing. Are you presenting the Bible, presenting yourself in the way that Christ intended it to be? That's what I'm asking. This is where we start to move towards now. Now you know the enemy's been defeated. He's not here to torment you. You're here to torment him. You're here to basically, he's disarmed. Well, the enemy's a roaring lion, brother, and you need to know that. Well, guess what? It doesn't mention his teeth. He's a roaring lion, right? Is that right? Like a roaring lion. That is what, thank you. Like a roaring lion. It never mentions his teeth. Why? Because his teeth have been yanked out of his mouth. He's been defanged. I'm sorry to give you that impression. But he has no teeth. He can't sink into us. Well, you don't understand. He's still got claws. Well, he's been declawed too then. Come on. Why? For so long in my life, it has nothing to do with anybody that I've mentioned, but my own self. I've had Jesus, okay? What is he? He's the healer. He's the redeemer. He's all these things. But I walked around in a lot of stupidity, but a lot of the time it's been, man, life isn't fair. Man, if my dad would have done this and if my mom would have done that and if I would have made this and if I would have tried harder, if I could have known at 13 what Xander knows, and I'm just using him as an example because he's on my mind right now, but what that young man knows to the level that you know it, Xander, I don't know where I would have been. It would have been a lot different, but he has such a revelation. I'm 28 years old, and I'm just now fully trying to get that revelation that I am a son of the King. I've got a ring on my finger, and that ring comes with an authority that I am a son of the Most High. He is under, we sang it over and over, and it's all good and grand. What Ashley does, well, she can fire you up, and I'm telling you, it's authentic. But we get in here, we're like, yes. We run around in circles. And I'm not saying it is all spirit. It isn't all spirit. It doesn't matter. What I'm saying is we come into this building, we rally together, which is we do a good job of doing that. But it seems like the second we walk out the door, and I'm speaking from my own self here. It's like, when 5 minutes ago, I was standing right here doing this, you're an army dressed for battle. I've got the giant. I've defeated the giant. You've defeated the giant, but I have victory to you because I'm a co-heir with you. And I won't even tell you sometimes it comes to my mouth. I'm being real. And if you're holier than thou, you can throw the first stone. That's great. But I'm just telling you, we have a victory. And we have, with victory, there's a responsibility to speak life and to speak that victory. Go ahead, and just to confirm this, so I'm not making this up off my head, Amy? Who got the last word, O death? And O death, who's afraid of you now? You can just stop right there. That's all we need to know. We are living, breathing. We will never experience death through the sense that many of our people in our world are going to experience it. Are you walking in power and authority? Are people being healed by your shadow? Are people even feeling your shadow? It's going to make some people mad. It's going to make some people uncomfortable. But if you don't encounter a demon or an enemy person, you might want to make sure that you're not walking in the same direction. They're defeated. You're not. Are you walking in the same direction? I'll leave it at that. That was an awkward silence. Good, Elder Craig, thank you. I want to wrap it up pretty quickly. We're going to blow through some stuff, so just hang with me. Keys to victory. One, the most important. Write this down. It's a lifesaver. I promise you it's a lifesaver. You ready? You need Jesus. There's no victory without him. You need him day and night, night and day. Every single day you need him. But the first thing is you've got to say to him yes the first time. We can talk about power. We can talk about authority. We can talk about salvation, redemption. We can talk about all these things. But if there is no salvation, if there is no deposit, and there's no admittance, there's no belief. Go read John 1:12. For those who believe and accept, they have the right to be called the children of God. Are you a child of God? That's the first question. I can't go through the next point. I can't go to the next key to victory until you know. Hear me. If you do not have Jesus, which I'm looking at most people in this room that I know, so I'm praying, but only you and God know that. You need Jesus. You can't do anything without him. Salvation, every morning, if you're a believer, it's every morning, I need Jesus. I love me some me, but I love me some Jesus too. So I need him. He loves me too. And as 1 Corinthians 15 says, we are the victors over death through Christ. He did that. Thing is, all we got to do is say yes. Now, is the yes always easy? It's simple, but it's not always easy. But first key is you need Jesus. Christ has conquered and won. When we're opposed by Satan, it's a fixed fight. You've got to know that. Talk about boxing, MMA, and wrestling, and all that stuff. That's all it is. We walk into the ring, they can just go and hold up our arm. We've won. You need Jesus. I'm sorry that you're having to do this nonstop, but I can't stand still, ever. So you're doing a great job, by the way, I'm sure. Number two, get in the Word. Speak the Word. And when I mean Word, right now, at this time, I don't mean revealed Word of God. I mean this thing, the written Word of God. Well, I know John 3:16, brother. That's a great start. That is based, our faith is based off that. But you need verses for every situation and every, people are going to come to you. I'm telling you, this is one thing I do know. There's a young man who was actually supposed to be here tonight, but I gave him a break and told him he can go to summer fun with his family. So, but he came to me. He's like, man, I'm hurting, man. Like, I know God loves me. I think God loves me, but I'm this and blah, blah. Dude, again, what did I just say a second ago? John 1:12. Have you accepted and believed? Yes, I have. You are a child of God. It doesn't get any better than that. Nothing. You've got to know the word. You have got to get in the word. They are probably so stinking tired of hearing that, the youth. It's okay. Thank you, Selma. Thank you, Selma. an inside joke. But it's the truth. You have got to get in the word. And I'm going to be real. With my generation, although if we're living in the same time, technically we're all the same generation, I'm tired of the generational lot. Here's the soapbox for a moment. Rick, you got something to give me, man. All of you. Rick Solomon, I'm sorry, like looking at you and said, Rick Solomon, you've got something to give me, and I need it. Yet, I've got something for you as well. Because there's neither Greek nor Jew, male and female, slave nor free, right? You have something you've got to give me. There is no generational gap or divide. But if there is one thing that I can say that generally speaking, people in and around my age and younger, is we got away from reading the word. It's way too easy to go, verse of the day, Facebook, boom, there you go, you're welcome world, but not have a clue what it means. Get a handful of verses, get into the word, chew on them. Kim, when she talks about it, is the funniest stinking thing. She cracks me, she's like, no, 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 no. She's like the Cookie Monster. She just wants the word. And I love that. But we need the word. We have got to get into it. And I don't mean like what I'm doing right now and you're hearing it like that's my word for the day. We heard about that in Tennessee, and it was the most on-point thing that he said, in my opinion. Thank you, Father. We sit there mumbling the word. We have got to speak the word into existence. We have to. He gave it to us. That's, again, it's another loaded weapon that we have that we can use. It's in our arsenal, and we speak it. Sometimes people just need to have love with skin on it, and I get that. Touch them, pray for them, do that thing, but they need the word of God over the life. You've got to get into you first, because you can't give them something that you don't personally have. Well, here's John 3:16, and here's Romans 8:28, and how many of us don't even know that? We have got to get in the word. We have got to get in the word for victory to remain, and that's another key thing is too. What do you do after victory? You inhabit. You generally speak, and I'm going to use the Romans. I'll just use the Romans for example. So they would go into a place, they would conquer it. And then that city or that town would begin to look like them. Does temple look like us? It look like me right now currently, or the way that I think that it should look personally. But there should not be this gap between us and them. I'm an evangelist. Sorry, I can say stuff and get thrown out of a church. I'll go to the next one. So it's okay. But there should not be this gap. We should be infecting it. The VA, Scott and White, school district, all our school district employees, whatever you're doing, mortgages. Is that place beginning to look more like Jesus, because you got in the word and you're speaking it? That's another. You got to speak it. You cannot remain silent. That is why I'll save you CNN, Fox News, NBC, anything you want to do. Here's why it's failing. Because we are not opening our mouths. We are not speaking it. Speak forth the word. I got all excited in that part. Take the scroll. I eat the scroll. That partly, I know it didn't mean all this, but hello, it's okay. You've got to eat this thing and repeat it. You have to. It's not optional. When Jesus, let me ask you this. When Jesus, and I know we all know this story. When Jesus was in the desert, Satan comes up to him. Hey, man, what's going on? They kind of had this transition. Jesus could have been like, I am the Son of God. You son of a gun? You know who I am? I was put here by God to bring his kingdom. And walk away. That could have been the end of the conversation. What did he do? It is written. Man shall not live on bread and bread alone. It is written, it is written, it is written. If he did it, here's a novel idea. Maybe we should pick it up and do it. I love you, but that's the truth. Hang in there, peeps. Hang in there. Hang in there. Know it. Know it. Know it. Know it. Know it. Know it. Speak it and apply it. Number three. That's something we also talked about in Tennessee. So I won't say maybe, yeah, it's as important in my opinion. Number three, victory, where at? Anybody that went to Collide, come on. Where are we supposed to win? How do we win? Victory in the sacred place. Prayer. You can say, we can say prayer, we can do whatever you want to say. You have got to win. Rob, dude, holy cow. Humble what you said, and you know, Kim touched on again tonight. Humble yourselves and pray. How many times have we really humbled ourselves? Gotten literally the closet or whatever it is, your car, wherever you do it, and humble yourself and pray. And then, and grieve. And then what? What does he do after you've done that? Heal. Okay, obviously, this is a good word. Heal the land, right? Correct? He's going to do that. He says that he will do that if my people call upon my name, right? So we have to enter into a secret place where we talk to God. God talks to us. Not 5 minutes, not, thank you, brother. Thank you, thank you, thank you. All stinking day. But you've got to get into that. There's got to be that intimate place. I'm just close my eyes for a moment, just thinking about the intimate place of where you're talking to him. He's talking to you. Well, I don't hear the voice of God. Well, that's not biblical. Sorry. Get mad. Be offended. Again, don't care. It's not biblical. You talk to him. I use the illustration. When Kaylee comes running, am I like, oh, man, there she goes. No, when she comes running, what do? Come here. Most of the time. But fair enough. He's a better father than I am, obviously. But when we call out to his name, he's like, oh, baby, come here, come here, come here, come here. Jesus is like, hey, let me show you this. Hey, Holy Spirit, I'm going to comfort you. You've got to win in the secret place. He will not let you win in public if you are not winning in the private place. I guarantee it. Jesus himself said it. You cannot go and lay hands. You can't do any of this stuff. Maybe you can. There's grace for that, I guess, certain times. But I'm telling you, a sustained amount of time, you cannot consistently go into public and be and let the Son be glorified through you. Why is that man, Jesus, why is that man, why is he lame? Why is he blind? Whatever it is. Sins of his father's mother? No. So the Son of God can be glorified. Why is there oxygen in your lungs? So the Son of Man can be glorified. And you have the private victory so that when you step in, I just want to make sure we're all, you can see and do this thing. When you're here, whatever it looks like, but this is normally how I pray, but when you're here, and I had this vision when we were in Tennessee for one of the young ladies that was with us, but I saw her as well. But when you push yourself up, heaven says amen, and hell goes oh no, because there's an authority that takes place in that secret place. Yes or no? Yes. Thank you. Oh Jesus, you're so good. Number four, strike first. The reason why I say this is that most of the time that most of us are calling out to God, it's because we've got about 15,000 arrows in us, and we finally go, okay, well, I suck. Can you help? Fire first. Fire first. What I mean by fire first, speak love. Speak destiny. If you got kids, every single day, speak it over. Every single night. This is one thing on a daily basis, at least when I'm home, I know Kim's home. You're amazing. Your prayer and just speaking stuff into her that we've watched your healer. When that little girl walks into my grandfather's house, he might have been like this and morphine. Because he's in hospice, morphined out is the only way I can put it. In a daze, when that little girl walks in there, wide awake, because she spoke healer inside of her belly. Since we're a Christian audience, inside of her belly. She was speaking that your hand, you're going to be a healer, right? Is that right? Make sure I got it right. I don't want to mess it up. That you're a healer. She's going to be a healer, and she's bringing peace. She's going to do these things. The people that are sitting over here that we brought up earlier, when that young lady walks in their house, I mean, everyone comes to life. Because we're striking first and saying, no, 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 no. No one else is going to tell you who you are. If we do not tell, I'm loving on her mind, if we do not tell them who they are, somebody else will. Come on. We got to strike first. That's the problem. Well, I'm supposed to be this. No, 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 no. We learned something, again, I keep talking about Collide just because it's on my mind, but that one of the guys that was there, his little girl, gave him this little nugget, basically, and the mother was like, hey, baby, you know, how'd you get so beautiful? Daddy says so. It's my kid. Go ask her. You ask her. How'd I get so beautiful? Daddy said so. I'm striking first, so when the enemy does come against her, because some numbskull will come against her, or some hussy will come against her and say something against her. No, 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 no. I'm a daughter of the Most High King. My daddy on earth says I am. And what you say doesn't matter. We have to strike first. We have to strike first. A lot of the time, striking does look like love. I know, but you got it. We have to fire the first shot, is what I'm getting at. We can't allow the enemy to shoot it. Again, what? We've already had the victory. We've already won. Still there? Good. We've already won. But we have to fire the first shot. Stay with me for just a moment longer. You need to verbally proclaim God's word, glory, and goodness over your life and your sphere of influence. Now, when he said, Elder Rob said that on Sunday, I'm like, oh my gosh, he is so in my wheelhouse right now. You have a sphere of influence. Sometimes it's standing in line at HEB, Walmart, wherever you are, but you have to proclaim these things. People at HEB need it. Yeah, they need it too. You're going to tell me that when you go into the store, I have no idea, but let's use Walmart on Adams. How many people? Like, I don't know, 200, 300 maybe? You're going to tell me there's not a single person that you as a child of God are not supposed to go speak to and fire the first shot on somebody else's behalf. You going to tell me that? We have got to do it. We have to proclaim it. Sometimes that's the way it works, because sometimes it's inappropriate to go, God, go to Jesus' glory, and I get it. All circumstantial. But a lot of times it is speaking it out loud. People need to hear it. Point five. And almost it ties everything together, but goes back to number one. Point five. We win. That's all there is to it. That's all this is about. I wanted to show you just a brief picture that your enemy, that we give a capital E or a capital S as an eternal type of thing, he's not your eternal thing. He is a loser. That's what he does, is lose. Number one loser. That is his job. That is his title, is loser. But how many times are we going to, loser, I'm losing this, I'm failing, I'm stupid, I can't do this, I'm doing these things, I'm doing that. That's not who you are. If you don't know that, and you don't know Jesus, and you do know Jesus, but you don't know that you're a son or you're a daughter, that you have the gift of the Holy Spirit, if you don't know these things, find someone on this pastoral team or elder team or deacon or somebody, and you need to have it spoken over you. Our enemy, I said I was going to finish quickly. I am, I promise. It kills me. It hurts me physically sometimes to sing these words. I'm being real. I give it all to you, God, or I give it this. One time we were singing, I guess it was the bridge or whatever, I surrender all, and I was like, I surrender some. Honestly, that's what I was saying. I knew it wasn't the truth. We as a church, we as a community, there's other churches that are represented here tonight. We as a community, Williams County, Bell County, we are in the state of Texas. I'm not trying to be one of those prophetic weird, not that you're weird, I promise, not that you're weird. But no, because I want to be weird too. So, but I'm being serious. Where are we located at? Give me just easy. Thank you. She listens sometimes when I talk. We are located in the heart of Texas, right? So we are in the heart of this. And you look out at a map and you see these things going out, these arteries, these highways, these byways, these certain things. And we have these things but we are at the heart of Texas. Are we pumping life into the state of Texas? Are we pumping life into, let's just start here, Belton High School, Temple High School, Holland 2, I guess. I'm just kidding, dude. Troy, wherever you're at. Oh, sorry, there you are. My bad. But are we? Are we proclaiming victory? Are we walking on a territory? Because my feet are blessed. So every time, as much as irritating as it is sometimes to go to my job, I'm being real. But every time that I walk in there, when I step through that threshold, the place should be blessed. Well, brother, that you're saying you sound entitled. I am entitled. Gosh, dog, like we get so far and we're so politically correct. I don't know when to be a suffering servant. Just No, you have the power and the authority to change the sphere. That's right. Better yet, you have a responsibility. Command, love him, love them. All the other ones fall into place, right? Right? All the other ones fall into place. Love him, love them, boom. Well, what about love him, love them is done. We overcomplicate it. I'm a son of God. Take the territory. Take it, take it, take it, take it, take it, take it. One last offensive word, if you don't mind. This is totally off topic. I just wanted to, I didn't even matter. I'll just tell you what it said. A very important, not important, influential person, since I went to, we got to go to Collide, and I looked to Chris Brooks and his family and their ministry. If you don't know him, look him up, bless him, watch their stuff. The dude is on point. But his wife sent me a message today and said, I pray for an extra outpouring at your gathering night. I'm praying. And she went on a little bit more and prayed for it. I'm like, she doesn't even know that I'm actually preaching in big church tonight, so how's this going to go down? But he said something. He said something when we were there. I think it kind of goes with victory as well. Zombie Christians. What's a zombie? Is it dead or is it alive? Well, brother, it's dead because I don't understand zombies. I'm not that dude. I don't watch Walking Dead. I'll pray for you if you do watch Walking Dead. But we're zombie Christians. You're smiling big, dude. Somebody is. But it's the truth. We have zombie Christians. It's like we're alive in Christ, which is in the Word. We're alive in Christ, sort of. But we're also kind of dead over here, too, when we're hanging out with the world. Which is even worse. It is. I said it earlier. I would rather see somebody who's a gung-ho pagan than a Christian who comes in here. No, I'm not going to go there. But who comes in here lukewarm. You can't do anything with it. He said, Luke, but we're zombies. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. I'm not being sacrilegious. Don't even go there, people. But praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. And we walk out the door and we're living just like the world. There's a blur. There's nothing there. We're walking around half dead, half alive. Are you on the fence? You're not. Somebody that sits on the back row, bald head and long goatee, said earlier today that if you straddle the fence too long, you will fall. And for at least a great majority, they're going to hurt bad. I don't mean, I do. I'm stepping on your toes. Get on or get off. Because I can tell you that God is calling us. We just had 2 weeks ago. We had 2 or 3 weeks ago. I promise you, this might be the end. It might be the end. It might be the end. Thank you, brother. They get this every week, so bless them and just give them money and stuff or something. And Whataburger. Whataburger makes them all happy. But we have got to step in and realize this authority. It's not being preached enough. But we have people come in here and say, y'all need to be ready, and your church has been primed. You're ready for the harvest. You're doing these things. You've been waiting. Here it comes. I'm just saying in the natural. I'm looking in the natural only. That's all I'm doing. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, damn, I'm done counting. And I'm beating some people up that aren't here. But the truth is, a lot of that falls into our responsibility. It's still our responsibility. Yeah, the prophet came here and spoke the word. Well, here's the problem. That word comes from God through a person that is encouraging you. The thing is, it's only potential. You're a sniper, Jared. You're a sniper. Every time people keep saying it. You're a sniper. You're a sniper. Here's the deal. I'm not shooting a rifle. I'm not learning how to, metaphorically speaking, prophetically speaking, I'm not training myself for my eye to watch currently, to watch What she said is destroy the works of the devil. I'm going to be able to see these things, call them out, and just destroy them before they even happen to protect people inside this church. I didn't do anything with it. I'm about to, because I just preached this word, and guess what? I'm held accountable to it now, even more so. And I'm held accountable through every single ear that just heard it. So now I got to start living it, even more so. We have got to know, one, we have the victory. It's done. We're stepping on his head. It's over. You have to wake up. You have to wake up, and your feet hit the ground, or whatever you do, however it is, hell should be trembling, going, oh, he was asleep for only 2 hours, because that's how much we normally sleep, but... But whether it's 2 or 12 hours, when your feet hit the ground and your eyes open up and you've had the cup of coffee, whatever you need, your Dr. Pepper, I don't, just, hell should be going, no. Oh, Scott and White is going to be wrecked today. Okay, what can we do? Give her a flat tire. Make her husband say something stupid, 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 stupid. Or, you know. But that's the truth. We have got to see. We have to see. The authority and the gift that has been given to us. You're a son, Benny. You're a son. I think him. Thank you, Jesus. You're right. There it is. You're a son. You're a daughter. Love him. Love them. Walk in victory. That's where it's at. You are the tormentor, not him. I love you. You're amazing. Stand up, please. All right, let's pray, because that's one thing left to do. Father, we thank you for tonight, and we thank you just as a community, as a family, as a church, we can come together, break bread, and receive, and give, and receive. Holy Spirit, pray that you would, anything that was of me, you break it off right now, and anything that was of you, you take it and it takes root, God, and it blooms. Let it bloom. I pray for a righteous boldness for anyone who's timid, anybody's afraid, any situation right now that looks like the enemy's winning, that the scales would be removed, God, any hindrances that they will not, that they would be able to see, a person would be able to see that they are meant for victory in every situation, not some, not the big ones, not just the big ones, but the small ones too. That we live in victory, that we're the tormentors. Father, if there, it'd be silly not to say this, but God, if there's anyone in this room tonight that doesn't have the first key and they do not know Jesus and they need Jesus, Father, right now I pray that the Holy Spirit, that you would tug on their hearts tonight, God, that you would illumine yourself to them in this very moment, God, that tonight is that night, God, that they would see it, and so then they step into it. They come with a fire and authority as well. There is no junior Holy Spirit, so we know right now if that person is here, God, that you would hit them and they would have it and they would see you and repent and believe, God, and speak out loud the name of Jesus. Daddy, you're a good dad and you love us. Jesus, thank you for the victory, because without you, we don't have it. Thank you for freely giving your life that we may have that victory. God, let this town, this region, these schools be infected with crazy lovers of you and crazy lovers of people. And that we would be a template of how to love this church and this house. That we would be a template of love. God, that people would walk in and see victory on us and know that we are royalty and that we have a destiny. It's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen.
Amen. One last word before you leave. Two parts. Number one, remember that because of the team where they are, if you mention stuff on social media, Facebook, Twitter, or whatever, do not say the nation's name. The less that's out there, the better for security purposes, okay? Number two, before you go to bed tonight, remember to continue to pray. Pray yourself to sleep. Let your subconscious keep praying in the night watches or whatever, because that's where they are going to be confronting the enemy. While we, if the Lord doesn't keep you awake praying all night, then if you do get some sleep, while you sleep, they're fighting. They're doing what God's called them to do. So take it seriously. Amen. They're an extension of this body. They're the heads, actually, but because of where they are, we are there. Amen. Thank you. Bless you. See you later.
And shout it up.